Labrīt! Visiem, kuri pieslēgušies SEB organizētās izaugsmes programmas uzņēmumiem, nu jau ceturtajai lekcijai. Un šodien mēs runāsim par mārketingu, par izaugsmes mārketingu, par to, kā efektīvi sasniegt savus potenciālos klientus, esošos klientus un nogādāt viņiem informāciju par jūsu pieejamo risinājumu. Tātad pēc tam, kad esat atraduši savu izaugsmes ambīciju, esat jau izpētījuši, kas ir jūsu lietotājs, kādas ir viņa vajadzības un tās viņa vēlmes un sāpes, ko jūs varat palīdzēt viņam atrisināt, esat jau sapratuši, kas tad ir tas risinājums, kādā veidā jūs palīdzēsiet saviem lietotājiem. Nu, tad tagad ir īstais laiks domāt par to, kā šos lietotājus sasniegt un kā viņus nu, piesaistīt savam uzņēmumam un savam risinājumam. Tad līdz ar to mūsu tēma šodien ir izaugsmes mārketings, jeb angļu valodā growth hacking, un arī šīs lekcijas kontekstā noteikti mūsu šīs dienas lektori diezgan daudz runās par savu pieņēmumu pārbaudīšanu ar tādām kontrolētām metodēm, par testēšanu, par eksperimentēšanu. Bet kā redzat, šodien mēs esam attālinātā formātā, jo mūsu šīs dienas lektori mums pieslēgusies no Somijas, līdz ar to arī lekcija notiks angļu valodā, bet es aicinu šīs lekcijas laikā patiešām būt ļoti aktīviem un uzdot savus jautājumus vai nu angliski, vai nu latviski, gan Facebook vai LinkedIn pasākuma komentāru sadaļā, jo mēs uz šiem jautājumiem, mūsu lektori, protams, šiem jautājumiem labprāt atbildētu jau lekcijas laikā iepinot tos savā stāstā. Bet tad tagad es arī pārslēgšos uz angļu valodu, lai stādītu priekšā mūsu šīs dienas lektori Marija Lukainen. So, Marija is currently the head of marketing at Icebreakers VC, which is an early stage venture capital fund. But actually, she has been in marketing-related fields since 1998, which is already quite some time ago. And I know Marie has had some experiences working together with various companies from both Scandinavia and also Baltics. But I think one of very interesting things and very notable things I would say that Marie has done in her career is actually that she helped to grow Finnish cleaning service platform Fresca from 700,000 to 13 million turnover in just 2 years. And it's all been done using the methods that Marie will share with us today. So she definitely has some tricks up her sleeves and I think a lot of practical experience that you will be able to learn from her. So I guess some things regarding strategies and also very practical things like funnels, KPIs, metrics, and so on will be something that Marie will be touching upon today. Right, Marie?
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Thank you. Should we go into the presentation then?
Yes, let's do so. Okay.
Amazing. Good to meet you all. Can you see my whiteboard as well?
Yes.
Amazing. Amazing. Cool. My name is Mari Lukkainen. I'm from Icebreaker, which is an early stage startup fund. So if anyone is listening to my presentation, if you're interested in funding, please send an application. We fund idea stage companies. So even you are working in a corporate life right now, but you have idea to change something to be something else, better, more efficient something, you could be a potential investment for us. Today, I'm going to talk about growth hacking. My topic is growth hacking, why and how. We are going to go to more specific into marketing topics as well. But what is very important for me is fundamentally to understand that most of the growth bottlenecks in companies are not related to only marketing. So in order to actually like really achieve that hockey stick type of growing that Fresca, for instance, achieved, you really need to do it a little bit more cross-functionally, not only from the marketing silo. My presentation style is interactive. So I write and draw on the on the whiteboard, which means that if you have any questions, go ahead and ask. If you need anything like a more specific explanation about something, please go ahead and ask. I'm very deep into startup scene currently. So if I forget to explain some terminology, I try to remember to explain everything. Please go ahead and ask or Google. That is also something that I teach quite a lot. You need to Google to find things out because, well, no one knows. Like I could grow the cleaning company, but it was really 9 months testing and iteration before we actually achieved the stage of holistic growth. But yeah, let's go into topic, but don't hesitate to ask questions and interrupt me at any time. I try to check the chat every now and then to kind of see if there's something I can answer, but we will have plenty of time at the end of the presentation as well. But anytime you wanna like highlight something or ask, go more specific into your case, please feel free to interrupt anytime. Growth hacking, why and how? So I will tell a little bit about my career first because it kind of like gets everything together into this point of realizing what I should do and how it should be done. As mentioned, I started my career quite young. I was a nerd girl from very, very small town, middle Finland, and I just loved computers. I loved internet. I was in a fortunate position that my mom used to work in the local school where I could go to like play around with computers and so on. When I was a kid, we didn't have an internet connection at home back then because it was super expensive. I wanted to like, I made different websites. That was something that I really, really like. And then I got money from them. So I participated in some early affiliate programs, affiliate marketing programs means that you have a website or email list or something like that, like a marketing tool basically, and you will use that to advertise it to some company like travel agencies, insurance companies. There was different kind of programs. And then if you get visibility, so you show the banner on your website, let's say a travel agency banner on your website to large audience, you will get money. So that was what happened. And then it escalated. I figured out that, okay, my family is not so keen to like buy me the latest game, so I can do it myself by doing affiliate marketing. So I built more and more website, and so it escalated to a career in affiliate marketing. I've had hundreds of different websites. What it also meant was that I really learned to build everything myself, like not only the programming websites part, because this was really age before WordPresses and all the tools. So I really built everything myself by hand. There wasn't any editors to build the websites. So what I learned was that how to build those myself. But what I also started to learn was the business side, right? Because you needed to figure out like what kind of content you should basically produce to get traction for a travel agency or insurance company or bank or electricity company or whatever. There was a lot of different industries representing the like that one that you use, that's affiliate marketing as a tool to get more traction and clients. So I started to figure out also like what kind of websites I should make. So I had a lot of like, let's say, TV package comparison websites and so on. So I started to think about the business side as well. And pretty much everything. And since I didn't have any funding, obviously, I used all the income that I got from my affiliate marketing to basically like reinvest in the machine itself. So I started to purchase, let's say, Google Ads when Google Ads became like mid or early 2000. It took a couple of years before there wasn't any any advertising mechanism, but first of them was Google Ads. So I started to invest the money and learn kind of like this small scale, like I get money from the advertising, what do I do with the money? Okay, I purchase video games, but I also invested back in the growth machine, right? So that was something that I learned pretty much myself. And it was amazing way to learn it. Like a lot of people ask me usually, like, what is my education? I don't have any relevance for this type of stuff, but I've learned everything like this, like trial and error. That has been kind of the story of my life. Marketing in like affiliate marketing industry started to mature more in late 2000. So it started to focus more and more on loan comparison sites, and that meant also that it started to get very, very boring. I had had a couple of tryouts to kind of like to switch my career at that point to more in consultancy, but I didn't really, it didn't fly. Then I tried to do it myself because I didn't have any networks. So I ended up in consultancy companies, consulting big companies, major corporates, and consultancy in 2010-ish. I was consulting big companies, and that was very weird because what I realized that is that, okay, I get a lot of money about like by doing reporting, but no one really wanted me to do anything with those reports. Like nothing really happened. Like I could produce like month over month, 6 months only reports, and no one cared. I reported that, okay, you're spending 20,000 euros in nonsense advertising. Like, first of all, there was one of these like a pension in insurance company that was spending this 20,000 euro on advertising in the gaming site where the kids were clicking accidentally the ads of the entrepreneur pension program. So it was really nonsense, and I couldn't just get it. Like, why would you want to waste money like that? But no one really saw any problem on that, and that kept really bugging me. I found myself to startups in like a couple of years after this. So startups. So I started to first consult startups, and then I ended up being like a position of head of marketing or something like that. And in startups, I kind of like as a head of marketing of startups, I had all the mandate to do everything related to marketing. But if the problem is somewhere else, so here we have the marketing silo of a startup, and usually growth hacking is here in the corner of marketing silo. But when I continue with my story, you realize that you can't really make any difference from there. So I started with marketing, but if you happen to have an issue with your product, then it's completely another silo, another function. You can't really do anything about it. And especially like we are digging deeper into home cleaning industry. In home cleaning industry, it's even more complex. It's not only marketing, but it's also talent. So basically recruiting cleaners, recruiting programmers, customer care people, recruiters themselves, because you need to build massive recruiting function to, well, pump the cleaners in all the time. And then you also need to keep both parties happy, so clients and cleaners, so you will have customer success or a customer and cleaner success in Fresco's case. So basically, when you start from marketing, that is like the growth bottlenecks don't end up here. So it will move forward when you do your thing in marketing. So basically in cleaning industry example, you start with marketing, so push clients in, but nothing happens, like the growth doesn't like definitely happen, especially in cleaning company context, because no one is cleaning if you don't do cleaner recruiting. So that's the next bottleneck immediately. Then the next bottleneck is customer success. So you need to keep everyone happy to to keep retention up, keep the lifetime value up, so the clients stay in your company as your company's clients for years instead of like trying it once and then like a churning, they stop purchasing it immediately. So we want to keep them for years because like we invest a lot of money to acquire the one client, so obviously we don't want to lose them, right? We want to keep them for years. And same goes cleaners. So if we acquire a very, very good home cleaner, we want to keep them for years to keep the clients happy. So it's really like the dynamics of both of these parties, clients and cleaners, both are very, very valuable. Then it's product. So you can, optimize a lot of stuff in cleaning company. And then when everything works here, you can go back to marketing to acquire more users. But how can you have impact on all of this instead of just being stuck in marketing function? That was basically what I ended up doing at Fresca. So 2017, I started as head of growth at Fresca. And head of growth at Fresca's case meant that this was my position. I was middle of everything. My main KPI, so key performance indicator, was revenue. So basically my mandate in this company was that, hey, welcome to this company, do more revenue, do whatever it takes to like get us more revenue. And that was really like a common mission of everyone at Fresca's early stages. And that led to our amazing numbers. So 2017, when I started, we had a little bit under a million annual recurring revenue. So this is a recurring cleaning business. These are subscription clients. So they subscribe, don't do like one-offs. So it was also recurring, very valuable revenue, annual recurring revenue. We also had like something like 30 people working at the company, and a little bit like something like two-ish million funding. 2018, I left my operational role in December 2018. Our annual recurring revenue was 30 million. We had over 800 people in the company in various roles. We had already three countries open, Finland first, then Norway, and then Sweden. And we also raised almost 15 million A round. It was something like 12 million, something like that. It's a big number for a cleaning company. It's not necessarily a massive amount of funding for a tech startup I usually work with, but for a cleaning company. And that really made me realize that it's also possible for this kind of like more traditional business with amazing numbers. Obviously, like these tactics, like as a disclaimer, these tactics are not only for VC-backed companies, so venture capital investment-backed companies. So you don't have to have that in your mind to implement something that I present here into your business. You can be a cash flow positive company. It's completely fine, and my agency. So I have also agency called Truly Agency that we have something like 40 plus clients currently. Something like half of them are VC backed startups, and the rest are just cash flow positive traditional companies. We have had e-commerce case where we doubled the 3 million annual revenue to 6 in 1 year. So it's definitely very recommended to try these tactics out. For more traditional business, you don't have to have any external funding to get some benefit out from something like this. At Icebreaker context, so basically my main thing, Icebreaker, if you want to check the website, we have over 90 early stage companies nowadays, B2C, B2B, a little bit of everything, almost all the industries. This type of tactics can be implemented in pretty much any industry, from home cleaning to programming agency to, let's say, quantum computing startup to, I don't know, like a VR simulator for head surgeons in Germany. So basically what I'm saying is that any type of industry at any stage you have, you should try out something like this. First of all, the kind of the strategic view is this, to fix all the growth bottlenecks, to be able to have some kind of meaningful impact on growth in your company, you need to view it from a little bit larger perspective, not only for marketing. Like, usually the marketing or lead generation or client acquisition is the first thing we start from. But you have to have kind of like a vision, like a, you have to be able to take the perspective, like the larger perspective, to see the a little bit bigger picture as well. Because most likely your growth bottlenecks don't end up here. I will go deeper into a couple of different cases on B2C and B2B, but usually on B2C cases, it's the next bottleneck is somehow related to retention. So how to keep the acquired clients happy and make them to buy a little bit more or turn to referrals or refer your business to their friends. On B2B, usually I'm dealing with sales-driven SaaS companies, and in those cases, the sales is usually the next bottleneck. So then we do completely something else than marketing. It's usually something related to sales development, CRM, transparency, something like that. That's about why is it important. So I believe that by implementing a little bit of these processes, like you don't have to implement the whole thing to get some benefit out, but we could have more and more these amazing success stories like Fresca or other like hockey stick type of companies in Nordics and Baltics. Definitely something to try out. Let's go into process then. And just to remind you, if you have any questions, like go ahead, please go ahead and interrupt me anytime. Core process of test iteration, so growth hacking is this. My recommendation usually is to go through this process weekly basis. So do it once per week, one time per week. The iteration process cycle can be even faster. At Fresca, at some point, I had a massive budget on marketing, especially. I had a budget of 100,000 euros per month per country. Obviously, with that kind of budget, you can run this even daily basis because you gather so much data. But weekly cycle is usually something that is very like. It's doable. Ultimately, this whole thing is about the routine of testing. So everything here like sounds like very, in a way, like no-brainer, common sense thing, which it is. But simple routines are very hard for human beings. Like you can think about this a little bit like that. You know how to well drink water, eat healthy, exercise, go to walks, but still it's sometimes a little bit hard to get yourself to actually do it. So basically, like, and then you may need nutrition therapists, personal trainers, so on, to kind of like build a routine, help you to build a routine. So this is a little bit same, that you need to build this boring, simple routine, and that is very, very hard for human beings. Usually, if you are able to build this routine, that you do these four steps, even at least a weekly basis, you will start getting some kind of intel that what works for your business. And from those learning experiences, you will get forward slowly. So four steps. I'm getting better at drawing these circles. First, before going into these steps, you will choose an KPI. So key performance indicator, what is the most important number that you should improve right now? And that can be anything. Like, it doesn't have to be revenue. KPI examples, so some kind of important number that makes sense in, like, from the perspective of getting your company somewhere. Think about it from what is your goal with your company? Like, if you are the company owner, like, it's most likely revenue, but what that revenue represents to you? Like, what do you get when you achieve that revenue? You get stable business, so you don't have to worry anymore, like, how to keep it, like, a little bit above the, cash flow positivity, or does it represent that you can finally buy that Tesla that you have been dreaming of for years, or does it represent the possibility of exit, so you can sell your company and do something else, retire a little bit earlier, or be financially independent, or does it represent that you are now able to raise some funding, external funding, to grow, like, outside from your first country, expand to the whole Baltics or further in Europe. So what does it represent to achieve this goal? It's very important to have some kind of, like, actual reason, actual vision, what this number represents to be really meaningful. Revenue is usually the most common one. So some kind of number, and this can be anything. Doubling the revenue, first 1,000 euro revenue, first 1,000,000 of revenue, turning your one-off customers to subscription customers revenue, something like that, revenue. Profit is another very common one. Increase profits. Now we are making 1,000 euro per month profit. We would like to make 50,000 euro profit to buy the Tesla something, but it can be anything else as well. And usually when we start to work with this kind of, like, big large complex KPI, you need to go a little bit deeper to understand, like, what are the components of revenue. Components of revenue are usually related to client acquisition, so number of clients coming in per certain amount of time. You can also split it into different sections. Leads, so number of leads, number of marketing qualified leads, so the people that you can send some newsletter to, or number of sales qualified leads, so the leads that your sales reps can call to, something like that. On e-commerce, especially, usually we do conversion optimization, so conversion percentage. We would like to get our conversion percentage from 1% to 3 to 5, which is usually the, like, healthy average of e-commerce conversion rate. Most likely, like, in home cleaning company example, you don't do anything with clients if you don't have the cleaners. So it can be something related to like a number of job applicants, or something like talent related It can be something like a rating, so some kind of quality number of the quality of your service. It can be productly related KPI, loading speed of your application, something like that. Or e-commerce, it can also be cart size cart size. So the size of like how many products are the clients like gathering in their carts. So instead of only getting 100 euros per one purchase, we would get 200 euros, right? So increasing the cart size, something like that. Also like another example, answering speed of your customer care, something like that. Just saying, it can be anything. Like, what is the most meaningful number right now for you to improve in your business? There's a couple of examples. When you have chosen the KPI, first you do analysis. So you will analyze your current situation. Like, we want more revenue. Where did we get the revenue that we have right now? Or if you are just starting, like, who could be our first customers? Like, we would like to first analyze like what could be the customer persona, and then we can create next the hypothesis, like where can we find them, or based in the current revenue that we have, how can we make a little bit more of that, something like that. And you don't like, this is usually the place where I'm asked like, well, okay, what kind of tools do you use? And people have the kind of like vision of growth hacking being like a kind of skill of using very complex, expensive tools and having a lot of certifications to do that. Completely not. My most efficient tool is Google Spreadsheet. So documenting everything on Excel. It can be notebook if you don't want to use Excel, but basically like just document it somewhere because that helps you to process the information, right? But don't make it complex. What we want to do is get you into this routine of systematic testing, because that is something that you can use to learn what could work for your business, for your industry, right? Third thing, prioritize the hypothesis. So what you should test, right? Prioritize it. Again, you don't have to use any tools. You can use scoring system if you want, but it's not necessary if you don't. Just use your common sense to think about this, these things. So success probability. So what do you think? Like, should we test expose right now when there is no expose? Obviously not, because you won't be successful. Should we test Facebook advertising because your friend that has an e-commerce store said that it could make sense? Definitely, yes. That sounds like that it could be very successful test. Next thing is resource efficiency. So how much resources you can and should invest in this? Like how do you feel like if I invest a lot of time and money on something that I really don't have that kind of like very, very good feeling that it should work, you shouldn't probably do it. So again, highlighting that this is really like in the end, like very like helping you to use your common sense thing to run this kind of process. You can usually figure this out yourself without any tools. Last thing, scalability, and this it's a little bit different case. Like if you are a venture capital backed startup company, then the scalability is a little bit like a more important factor than maybe resources efficiency. But if you run a cash flow positive small business, then obviously you should focus on something that uses your small resources efficiency. But think about it from your business perspective. What makes sense from common sense perspective, right? Then you go into testing and you test it. And also, like, remember, like, don't overanalyze it too much. Point of this thing is learnings. So focus on learnings. That can sound very, very no-brainer, which it is, but people are by nature very afraid of new things, very afraid of failure. Failure usually means that you will lose your pace and your trust on your skills, or you will lose your job. So people are very afraid of this type of, like, things happening, even they are not even like realistic. Especially in startup companies, like, they are not realistic because you really need to test something to find out the answers. Like, no one knows the answers, so you need to do testing over and over again to find out what could work. Like, I get a lot of questions because of my background, like, okay, what could work for my quantum computing technology startup? Like, I have absolutely no idea what is even your client, but what I can do is basically testing to find out. So ultimately, growth hacking is stolen from Jani from Logmore, which is one of our portfolio companies. Growth hacking is art of not knowing, but finding out. And how do you find out a lot of stuff? Well, testing, Googling, asking, these are the most important tools. Like, not anything technical, just really, really testing over and over again and iterating your hypothesis and tests based in what you will learn. And that is why it's also very hard process to implement, because people, like, they really want to overanalyze everything so they wouldn't fail in their testing. But the reality is that most of your tests will fail, and that will feel very bad. So it doesn't feel good to test something and find out that your test was completely, like, misaligned, we didn't find anything useful. But if you force yourself to test anyway, and you force yourself to focus on learnings, so from every single test, even the test didn't take your KPI anywhere, you will still learn something, right? That will take your business forward, ultimately. It can take time, it can take weeks, it can take months. On Fresca's case, it took 9 months hitting my head on the wall before I figure out the best, most efficient way to really do the hockey stick scaling. It took 9 months. It felt horrible. It felt like everything is against in the world, against my success with this cleaning company. But I wanted so bad for it to succeed, right? I wanted to employ hundreds of cleaners in this amazing company, because our company is really amazing place for the cleaners. So I wanted to just do it so badly that I kept trying over and over again, even it felt felt horrible sometimes. But that really, like, built my trust in the process. So and in every single case where we implement this, ultimately you will find something out. And this is the key. Like, it's a horrible finding for an entrepreneur that your baby, your company, wasn't that ready that you expected it to be, but you need to a little bit iterate it and change it. Change the product, change the your understanding what is the client, change something, or you need to change your business completely. So you need to close your current business and try something new. And that can feel like horrible failure, but from the big perspective, is it a good thing that you will stop doing something that doesn't work, and then you can invest your own resources, your time on something else based in your learnings? Most successful entrepreneurs have failed multiple times before they succeed. So it can take multiple iterations. Question in the chat. What is the ratio of failed and successful tests? I don't have any specific metric or kind of like, this is only my gut feeling, something like 9 out of 10 or even like 99 out of 100 tests are failing. So most of the tests are really failing and don't bring any traction, anything happening for the KPI. But what they will bring to you is this, so the learning. Because when you fail, and I would really encourage like not use the word failing because that is very important for the culture of your company, that we don't have it. We don't have such thing as failure. We have only healthy, interesting, exciting learnings, right? So if you focus on learnings, it will ultimately start feeling a little bit better and easier to kind of like constantly face the failure. But that was something that really happened at Fresca. Couple of things from Fresca, like why this growth hacking growth thing was so successful in this company. Components of successful growth slash growth hacking. Successful growth hacking. First of all, it will have an owner. Nothing happens if someone is not owning it, right? So someone has to have the ownership of also this thing. It has an owner. So I was owning the growth thing. What an owner takes care of is ultimately the process and communications. So it makes the process visible for the whole company. In practice, it means that the owner is documenting and communicating the tests and results and learnings to the whole company. And when you have someone communicating that, okay, we have this growth hacking thing in our company, and what it's doing is that we do these tests and we learn very important, interesting stuff. What it impacted at Fresca was that a lot of people that hadn't like, that didn't really think about that they are doing growth hacking or test iteration started to do it. Like for one example, we had amazing blue collar recruiters. So basically cleaning company recruiters that had absolutely no background in marketing or growth hacking, growth, anything like that. They started to figure out themselves what could be the most interesting, important numbers of our function. So basically they started to track cleaner demographics. So what were the top three countries of the most efficient cleaners? And that helped a lot that we were able to kind of like if you hire 800 cleaners, it's not only focusing on the cleaner recruiting is not only focusing on Nordics or Baltics, it's focusing on like a whole world. Basically you go through all the European countries systematically, and then you end up outside of Europe, and then you need to figure out how to employ a Filipino in Finland. So basically offer the job and training to get the work permit of European Nordic standards of home cleaning. So it's quite complex and fascinating world. But they started to basically figure out this themselves, because my background was in marketing. So I had absolutely no understanding like what could work in cleaner recruiting. But I didn't need to figure out myself, because first of all, we had this transparency of testing all the time, and the cultural kind of transformation of growth being the kind of like common goal of everyone. So I didn't had any kind of like no one wasn't saying that, okay, you marketing person, screw off, like get out from our function, we know what we do. Everyone was just excited to grow the company together, right? So they figure out the numbers themselves, and that was very, very helpful. And by collaborating with all the functions, we were able to documenting is the for things. So document our playbook of growth, basically. So if you want to open up new country, this is what you do on marketing. This is what you do on recruiting. This is what you do on cleaner training, everything, operations, everything, playbook. And that kind of playbook is very valuable asset when you raise funding. So documentation. Then last but not least, mandate. So here, if you have this kind of position, middle of everything, so instead of like being stuck in marketing silo, you need to have mandate to fix issues cross-functionally. So if you are the growth person of B2B company and you fix lead generation, but no one is doing anything for these leads because of various reasons, you don't have any sales reps. That's usually the biggest reason. Sales reps has that kind of like compensation model that they don't want to deal with inbound leads. They only want to do cold calling because they get more money. You need to have the mandate to do something about it. Not like mandate meaning that you will go and say that, okay, now you're fired, but like you will work together with the people in your company to fix the growth bottlenecks together. But you have to have a mandate to do that, so you're not stuck in your own function. If you are stuck in your own function, it doesn't mean that this is completely useless. You can still pick a number that you can really have some impact on. Client number, conversion number, what are you doing? You can start tracking something and make this test iteration visible in your company. And then you may get some buy-in from other functions to basically, to implement it in a more large scale, to get more mandate, get more trust, because you have shown that it works. Let's go a little bit deeper. I will present next couple of cases of a little bit overlap in marketing and everything else. But let's start from a B2B case. So this is usually the typical B2B funnel and the growth bottlenecks that we are nailing. So on funnel visualization, I use a tool called Pirate Metrics. Pirate Metrics is not invented by me. So if you want to dig more into that, you can find a lot of resources by Googling. Basically, it's a funnel visualization tool. So now we start visualization. A very typical B2B case that I'm dealing with. So if you have a B2B company, you may find something interesting here. And reminder, don't hesitate asking questions if you have any. Pirate Metrics funnel view starts from awareness. So to get any clients, any traction for your company, first of all, you need to make people aware that you exist. So awareness is the first thing that we solve. Then acquisition. So we'll acquire people somewhere. It can be expo stand, it can be your website, it can be cold calling, it can be anything. After acquiring the aware customers, your target audience, we will activate them somehow. Activation could be, for instance, downloading a lead magnet or visit on your expo stand to talk to your sales rep or something like that. Then usually after this, if you don't have product-led SaaS company, you will have some kind of sales function. So then we have sales happening here, and then we end up with revenue. We could continue this funnel view, by the way, by adding referral and retention, but let's try to keep it simple so we can focus on the main core things. Usually with the companies that I deal with, the core issues on B2B companies are related to marketing, so lead generation and sales. So I will focus on those currently. Traditionally, this is marketing. And then we have here, this is sales. And then we may have also like a sales development representative function before the actual sales, depending a little bit of your company. But now we can already see that this is cross-functional thing that we need to do. So it doing only marketing doesn't solve anything, because marketing really is only factor that impacts on revenue or B2B company, especially if it's sales driven, depending a little bit what you're doing. Then revenue part and everything happens after that. That's usually product and customer success, CS. Couple of traditional cases, what we do. Most of the B2B cases I work with find their audience from LinkedIn. So LinkedIn email advertising or feed advertising is something that we do to raise the awareness in a very optimal place. Think about these channels or tactics from the perspective of your target audience. So who is your target audience? Are they available on LinkedIn? Usually they are if it's a B2B case. So we use feed ads and email ads. You can't use email ads on in European Union due to GDPR reasons. So this is a little bit like a case by case. Like if you have audience in US or UK, thanks Brexit, then you can do email advertising. But if you you're doing only European Union advertising, then it's gonna be feed ads. But anyway, you can still raise the awareness in B2B channel. Google or search engine. So we may use Bing also as an add-on. Ads, so Google search engine marketing, Google ads, basically the ads that you see on Google. As you usually do if you have some kind of like purchase intent keyword. So basically, this is B2C example, but well, you can use B2B example as well. Home cleaning or cleaning, like office cleaning. If someone goes to Google and Googles office cleaning, they are not doing that for fun, right? They are doing it for purpose of finding, home cleaning or office cleaning service in that kind of case. So do you have that kind of like, I'm going to Google and find myself a solution for my problem work in your business? Usually there is something like that, not in every case. Especially if it's I have a lot of very new startup cases where you don't really have that kind of word, because because there hasn't been a solution for their problem, or they are not aware of their problem, then you may want to figure out something that is a little bit related to something like that. For instance, we have one software related to customer satisfaction SaaS service, and one of their keywords is how to use NPS, so Net Promoter Score system. It's not a Net Promoter Score system like a SaaS service, but it's one of the features or things that you can use there. So something like related a little bit to your business, but Google is based in keywords. So think about like what is kind of the area of your keyword pool. When you figure that out, then you may want to do organic as well. So organic Google is something that search engine optimization, trying to get some organic visibility. Then another channels like we like to use AdRoll, retargeting, targeting. I need to think about like how to actually pronounce and write this because I'm a fan. But retargeting is a mechanism of like a person is visiting your website, and then after doing that, they will see your banners everywhere. And AdRoll is really, really good for especially this type of retargeting because they have an access to authority medias. So, for instance, Forbes and TechCrunch. And that is usually very impactful in especially B2B, that someone sees your ad on LinkedIn, but they are not convinced because they don't know the brand. But then they start seeing your brand advertising on LinkedIn, not LinkedIn, but TechCrunch, Forbes, so on. So they get convinced because they get the feeling that you are a big company, bigger than you actually are, because you kind of have the money to advertise there, but the retargeting is very cheap. So that is a very tactical thing to do. A couple of other things we like to use as well. Quora, owned by Google. So this ask questions service. Usually there is some questions related to your field. So very, very efficient way to get some visibility. And also the answers get organic visibility on Google because Google owns the service. YouTube in some cases, Facebook also in some cases, but in most cases we start with this three and already get a lot of traction. Then we want to acquire, maybe I also put events there to go a little bit offline as well. Then we want to acquire people to our place. So basically get them to do something when they see the ads. We can acquire them to, if it's email ads, they can read your message already on LinkedIn. So email message is the place where we acquire them. In most cases, it's a landing page. So some kind of customized page on your website for this specific type of marketing. Or then front page. Or in event case, it's an event stand. So think about the place where you acquire these people, where they are going. What happens there? What is the message there? The message should be something that kind of it's a feels consistent. They got some kind of message on LinkedIn. You continue the same message on your LinkedIn email message or your landing page. Then we want to activate them somehow. Usual activation tactics. Email has opportunity to have form. So I like to use that on LinkedIn email if that's an opportunity. So a form to book a demo, get some more material, some insightful PDF, attend to webinar, something like that. On landing page, again, some kind of form, maybe demo already. Webinar sometimes, a very good way to activate it. And then we go into sales. So we'll get the contact, email address or phone number or something from these channels to our CRM. And then the sales is happening. So CRM, what usually happens is multiple things that we want to do. Email, text message, call. They are not answering, so you call them another time. You send them another text message, sometimes WhatsApp message, depending again about the case. More emails. You may activate more retargeting banners. It continues. Then you get the demo, and then we hope that that will end up in like doing revenue. And by visualization, visualizing your funnel like this, you can already see like what could be your bottleneck. So basically, first of all, do you have enough channels to create any kind of awareness, to get any traction? And what is the traction that you can get? You can draw this kind of funnels. So what happens? What happens when they see your advertising? Something like this. Do you know the percentage? Like, what is the number here of people going from your channel? You usually get the data of like how many individuals have seen your advertising. Like, what is the number? What is the percentage of people going to your acquisition point, your website, or opening up the email message? Does it feel like a healthy number? You can also Google like benchmark ballpark numbers to most cases. So you don't have to know like what is the healthy number, but this helps you to analyze like what is the bottleneck in our business, like what we should focus on. And that realization can get you into here, like to choose the KPI. What is the most important thing to improve in my business right now? Where is the bottleneck in this whole machine of a lot of stuff happening to create my revenue? Also, like when you go forward here, like is the issue here? Like, are we doing enough actions in our sales funnel to get the meaningful discussions with the potential prospects? So on. Like, what can you find here if you visualize your whole funnel? What are the actions? What's really happening there? Any questions at this point? Please go ahead and send. We can also go into more specific cases in the workshops later today with some groups attending on this session. But feel free to ask anything. That's it about B2B. Let's go to B2C next. I will visualize it in similar way. So we will have awareness, acquisition, activation, and revenue. And I will use Fresca as an example here. Even it's a cleaning service, that doesn't mean that this is something that like you can implement this to very big variety of different B2B cases. Fresca as a mechanism works like an e-commerce, so you can go to website and order service immediately with your credit card. So it's kind of like a e-commerce slash subscription business slash home cleaning, very traditional business. Usually in B2C cases, I like to start with Google for same reasons, that there is usually some kind of purchase intent keyword. Home cleaning, if someone is Googling home cleaning, they really, really want to purchase the service. So Google marketing, advertising, and organic Google SEO. Other places where you can find B2C people I like Facebook and Instagram network, so that's my next usually go to place. Then we have usually a little bit more traditional channels. At Fresca, one of our best channels is actually door-to-door sales. So basically, really like vacuum cleaner sales reps going to doors in certain areas and selling cleaning service. Definitely one of our most efficient ways. Very non-traditional events. And there is a lot of things you can optimize in events, like home cleaning is a thing that usually the target audience of home cleaning, like a user, is they have quite good income to purchase the home cleaning service. They have expensive hobbies. They want to purchase service because they don't have time to clean themselves. So you can find this kind of people, let's say, boat expos or horse expos, both expensive hobbies, takes a lot of time. So very like a good place to go and advertise home cleaning service. Besides to Facebook and Instagram marketing, I like to use influencers as well, actually. Influencers such as baby bloggers, baby Instagram influencers, really this micro influencer, like influencers doesn't have to use influencers, you don't have to have like massive budget. Obviously you can go to like buy like massive visibility from the top three bloggers, but in my experience that is definitely not worth of investments. If you think about the resource efficiency, most people the audience can rely on are the micro influencers. So the person that represents me, baby blogger, if I'm a baby, if I got the baby, I follow baby bloggers, something like that. If I'm a startup millennial, I may follow people like that, startup millennials doing their startup things. So what are the micro influencers that you could use? Usually they are very cheap. Best influencers at Fresca's case have only something like 200 followers on Instagram, like less than I do, but still they sell like, they can sell tens of subscriptions, even 100 new subscriptions annual basis. Because the people that are following them are kind of they get the feeling that, okay, this person who represents me can use home cleaning service as well. So why not buying it myself as well? I can try it out as well. Acquisition, in our case, we have some landing pages, especially for SEO. We have home cleaning Helsinki, home cleaning Stockholm, like specific landing pages for specific things. And then we have broad page for like more generic stuff. All these places you can start ordering home cleaning service. So you will enter the checkout. This is usually how B2C cases are working. You have some kind of checkout of starting the process of ordering service, or you collect items on your cart and then you go to checkout. And this is the place what you usually activate, like on activation, like what you optimize to improve your conversion rate. So how to make checkout as easy as possible for the people, and how to maximize the amount of people entering your site, entering the checkout and going through and ordering your service. So usually there is some steps again happening on checkout, like activating it, that we want to find out, adding items to checkout, on Fresca's case, scheduling the cleaning, adding more items, services. So basically, you start with something, but then you want to sell a little bit more. Maybe something referring to friends. So can you already implement in your checkout some kind of function that that do you have any friends that would love to use the service as well? Let them know, something like that. And then the payment. You can optimize quite a lot as well. Like, do you like what kind of do you accept? I don't know, cryptocurrencies. That could make sense for some businesses. And then what happens after the revenue? So what kind of message do they get? Do we try to sell a little bit more? But this is basically usually the funnel. Same thing here. Visualize it, what's happening in your funnel. How does it work? And what is happening here? How many people are going through? Are they stuck somewhere? And then think about with your common sense why they are stuck in scheduling the service. If you don't know, try to find a couple of people representing your target audience and ask. That is really, really, really efficient way to find answers. If you ask. That was something that I did a lot of at Fresca, that if I didn't know, like, let's say, why house moms from suburbs don't want to buy our service, I tried to find a couple of them somehow from Facebook groups, from our client base, from Market Square. That was actually one of the things that I did. I went to Market Square in Helsinki and asked 100 people, why are you not ordering home cleaning service? And got a lot of answers that I use in our communications, marketing channels, especially the communications, like how to convince Finns that you should try this home cleaning, which is also like try out letting immigrant into your place when you are not there. And the reasons like why people are not buying the service or why they are hesitant, you can find these reasons by, well, let's say, going to Market Square and ask people. But this is especially something that I really, really recommend you to think about, like how you can find the target audience, people that represent your target audience. If you don't have any questions, the last thing I will present to you is target audience iteration. First thing you want to do on target audience iteration is document it, because usually when I have a new case of a startup and they have some kind of issue, or startup or any type of company, they have some kind of issue of product market fit. So how to get first customers, how to get more customers. They have some kind of understanding what could be their target audience, but they haven't really documented anywhere. Start by documenting it and dig deeper. Usually when a person is like a startup founder or company founder, marketer is documenting target audience, they list things like okay, purchase motive is making their work more efficient. But dig deeper. What does efficient really mean? What is the number of efficiency? What the efficiency mean for that person? Is it that they will get to better position in the company? They will make more money, they will get more time free. These are the things they want to hear, not vague efficiency usually, but they want to hear that, hey, the service is making your life easier because it gives you more time. The service is making your work more efficient because you will make more money by doing X and Y, something. So dig deeper, what does the words actually mean? Like, what is the meaning of efficiency, cost saving, something like that? What is the number that you can track there? And then iteration itself. Iterate. Interviews. Find these people somewhere. Somewhere meaning Market Square, LinkedIn, if it's a B2B company, outreach them. think about what is the target audience, title, company size, everything, and just like outreach them, start talking to them, and find out, be interested about who they are as human beings and professionals. Facebook groups are a very good place to find these individuals. If you have B2C case, on Fresco's case, it could be like people in certain area, for instance. And people are very helpful. So again, focus on learnings is the key here. Learnings. So don't hesitate contacting them. Go there, be interested about who they are, ask questions, interviews, workshops. That was something that I did at Fresca quite a lot. Small group workshops to find out certain answers. Calls. And stuff like that. Usually companies think about that this should be very, very hard and complex and expensive, and you should outsource it somehow. But I really recommend to focus on quality over quantity in this case, because you can get very good insights by gathering couple of super users in, I don't know, WhatsApp group, gather a small community of super users, super fans in Facebook group, WhatsApp group, Slack community, Discord in some cases, some place that maybe Telegram in some cases, a place that makes sense for them, like some platform they are using. Also offline workshops, meetings are very good. They can become your brand ambassadors if you really listen to them and let them to have some kind of impact in your company. Also from the funding perspective, this is extremely efficient way. So from a funding perspective, if you have this small group of people somewhere and you can show that they are extremely active, they love your product, even it's only 10 people, 15 people, that can have a huge impact of raising some funding. Because you have the source of feedback loop, how to develop, improve your marketing, communications, product, customer retention, so customer success function things, how to develop your product in the future, so on. Any questions? Nothing yet. Maybe the small groups then, but like, what else? Maybe I tell a little bit, like we still have 10 minutes together. I tell a little bit about Fresca's target audience iteration. So Fresca has four different target audience iteration example. We have house moms, we have millennials, and these were the first two target audiences that we started from. House mom is a person 35, 40, 45 years old woman living in certain suburbs. Usually they stay at home, keeping like a stay home with their kids. They could be influencers, bloggers, something like that. They you can read them out from Facebook groups for babies and kids. There's a lot of Facebook groups for kids born in 2020, like certain groups, boys, moms groups, something like that. What they also love is certain influencers, like local Temptation Island host. Host is there, like this very handsome, long-haired guy. Like they like this kind of influencers. Efficient way to marketing to them is through the influencers, because they will be very angry to you if you say out loud that you shouldn't clean yourself, you should take a home cleaning service. But if a baby blogger is saying the exactly same message, then they believe it and purchase. When I joined Fresca, my realization was that I don't represent this audience at all, but I'm a super user of home cleaning service. So I'm a startup millennial that orders a home cleaning service because they are lazy and don't want to clean themselves. They hate cleaning. You can say that out loud to this target audience, and where you reach them out is craft beer expos, startup hubs, Google, because they actually Google for this kind of services, and Schloss, this startup expo. So dig deeper into kind of lifestyle of your certain target audiences, and think about like what kind of messaging and targeting would make sense for this. A year after, so basically we were working with these two audiences for a year already. A year after, a career mom joined our company and said that I don't represent house mom or millennial, but I could be the buyer of the service. So we started to opening up a new target audience. And career moms, they are a little bit different from house moms because they are very hard to reach out. They don't have any time to be in internet. You can, if you figure out their daily cycle, you can reach them out like in the morning by showing billboard ads. When they are driving to work, you show billboard ads at morning. When they are at work, you have a small window of Facebook and Instagram advertising when they are working. Then they drive back home, so again, billboard ads. Then they take their kids to soccer. If it's a household with under 100,000 annual household income, it's soccer. If it's above that, it's ice hockey. So you can do some collaboration with these kids' sports teams. Then what happens is they go back home. Again, they don't have time to go to internet, but you can do the door-to-door sales. So that's why it's so efficient for us. So basically the key to kind of like do efficient acquisition on this target audience is that you really understand the kind of like daily cycle of their lives. So what they do on a daily basis, like what kind of contact points you could have there. And it's really not only like online advertising, it's a lot of different places like that. You need to figure out what would be your contact points with this audience by talking to them, basically. And again, it doesn't have to be very fancy, expensive survey of thousands of people, just handful of people that you interview yourself. Questions to ask on these interviews is the questions you want to find out. If you want to find out what radio channels this target audience is listening, contact them and ask, what radio channels are you listening? That's the way of getting answers to questions, ask them from your target audience. Last audience is this like a city old folks, something like that. I don't remember the actual name, but basically 60 plus people in cities with adult kids. They don't wanna they wanna enjoy themselves, they wanna go to theater where you can find them, or a local cafe, enjoy some time with their friends, something like that. So they are the contact points. They use a lot of Facebook is total boomer media. So if you have boomer target audience, Facebook is definitely a place to be. Instagram for younger audiences, but try it out. You will see what works for you. But basically what I'm saying is that the iteration to figure out this, all of these took 2 years or over 2 years, because it actually started before I started at Fresca, but it will take a lot of time. So don't expect to have kind of clarity of your target audience immediately when you start doing these iterations. Document the information that you have and then start to dig deeper. Basically, like what could it mean, certain purchase intent, certain purchase barrier? Who are these as human beings? This is exactly something that B2B companies very often forget. They only list like kind of the professional features, like the company size, title, I don't know, something like that, company industry, but they forget completely that these people, even they have their kind of like professional identity, they also have their like other lives. They are using Google, they are using Facebook, they are listening to radio channels. If you can figure those out, you can actually find some channels, targeting tactics that your competitor didn't thought about yet. And you can be the winner of your category. That was really one of the success factors of Fresca, that we thought it really outside from the box. Cleaning companies were not really doing SEO, not really Facebook, Instagram marketing, not really influencers, anything. We did a lot of stuff that home cleaning companies hadn't thought doing ever before. And that was one factor why we were so successful. Okay, I think where our time is gonna be up in a couple of minutes. Hope you enjoyed. Irina, yes. Do you want to say a couple of words?
Yes, thank you, Mari. I think you gave us a really a lot of information and very, very practical tools on how to look at our companies. But maybe just like one last question, how to reflect. You are saying that growth is in the middle of both marketing and customer success and product. So it's kind of also in the middle of this strategy, right? So it's very much linked with marketing strategy. So maybe just kind of to sum up, more practically, how do you link it usually with this strategy in a perfect world, let's say so?
In a perfect world, it would start from having a company-wide leadership mandate. If you don't have it, it's really building the relationship to people that have it. So you would have first of all, the understanding of the strategy of the company. As a marketer, I speak to a lot of marketers who have absolute no understanding of the strategy of the company. Like, what does it mean to acquire a certain number of leads? Like, what is the big goal, big vision of this company? To find that out, talk to people in your company, talk to leadership. Usually they are positively surprised that you are interested about this kind of stuff. So definitely do it. If you are the founder or leadership of the company, think about it. Like, what does it represent to you to achieve certain type of goal? Like, what is the big vision? Like, what do you really want to achieve? There is no single answer. Don't take too much pressure. If you don't know the answer, I have a lot of discussions with startup companies that don't really have that. But like, I also have discussions with massive corporates where the CEO doesn't know what is the vision of the company. So the problem can be there in different size of the companies. But really, like, be interested about it. Ask questions like, what does it mean to achieve something that you should achieve? And that is usually how it, like, why growth marketing difference from the traditional marketing. It's more linked to the actual strategy and growth goals of the company. What this revenue, well, first of all, it's linked to revenue, and then it's linked to some bigger goal, bigger strategy, what the revenue represents to your vision.
Thank you. So I would say that also talking with people, both internally and of course externally, as with your clients, with your potential clients, these target audiences, and understanding them is also like a key component to all of this. So I think this is where we can round up. And thank you once again, Mari, for sharing all this information with us. I hope that our viewers have taken at least some examples from you, and that our viewers will implement these things, or at least try out some of them in their daily lives, in their daily businesses. As always, we are kindly inviting you to please rate this lecture by using the Mentimeter code or by scanning the QR code that you can see on the screen. And we will meet again in the next growth program session, just in 2 weeks, which will then be devoted to sustainability and how to start implementing it in your company. Thank you all for watching, and thank you, Mari.